Hi, I'm Andrew Edwards from the Windows Azure Storage team, and I'm here with
Jay from the Windows Azure Storage team too.
And we're gonna go over Windows Azure Storage, some of its architecture. We're gonna talk a little bit about authentication, how to use it, and give
best practices, scenarios, and we'll just cover all of those things today.
So I'll just jump right into some of and introduce Windows Azure Storage. So let's go through quick. So Windows Azure Storage is a cloud storage service that gives you anywhere and anytime access to your data. We have a variety of abstractions that we support, including blobs, tables, queues, and disks. Our infrastructure is highly durable and available and massively scalable. So you can easily build, and it helps you easily build internet scale applications. Our service today handles more than 10 trillion objects, and on average, we're processing about 1 million requests per second to our service. One of the advantages, of course, with Windows Azure Storage is that you'd only pay for the amount of storage and the amount of transactions that you use. And we expose our service through easy and open REST APIs. And we have client libraries, so you don't have to write to the REST APIs.
Yeah. Not many of them enjoy writing to REST directly, so we have provided these client libraries out there.
We have data centers all over the world that you can use, so a variety of locations in the United States, some in Europe, as well as some in China and Asia. The storage abstractions that we exposed, as I mentioned earlier, are blobs, tables, and queues, and we have these what we call concepts about how to use them and group them together. So our blobs are stored in what we call a container. Our entities for tables are stored within a table. And messages or queues store messages as well. And all of those are wrapped up in what we call a storage account. For each of these services, we have a URL that's specific to that. And it has your account name followed by the type of service. So for blobs, it has account name .blob.core.windows.net. For table, it's account name.table.core.windows.net, and queues are similar, account name.queue.core.windows.net. Blobs provide a simple interface to store and retrieve essentially files from the cloud. So you can store documents and pictures and videos and all sorts of different types of data that your service would want to have. You can do processing of big data because we can store lots and lots of large logs and do MapReduce over that data. And you can do backups to our storage in clouds. The tables are a massively scalable and easy to use NoSQL system. It's like just a basic key value pair or key value where values can be a variety of data. And you can store lots of user information, devices, metadata for your service, and all sorts of things in that key value table. And queues provide a reliable messaging system that allow you to decouple your one part of your service from another part of your service, and allow your roles within your service to scale independently without having to change the communication between them. They sort of provide this third point of communication. It allows you to schedule things asynchronously and implement some sort of types of persistent messaging, or build some sort of workflow based on top of that. We also have persistent virtual machine disks for the Windows Azure IaaS service. These are when you create a persistent VM, your disks or the persistent disks are stored in the Windows Azure service, and they're internally within the storage system. They're just a regular blob, and the file format of them is a VHD, just like a normal virtual machine is. So when your disk or your VM is doing an IO operation, like a read, it automatically, under the covers, gets translated into a REST GET. And when you're doing a write, it gets translated into a REST PUT call. We protect these blobs with the write-only lease, or to prevent other people from writing to them other than the VM, so that nobody can corrupt your data while your VM is using it. But this also allows you to read from the blob or from the VHD while the VM is writing to it. So you can actually sort of peek inside it if you really knew what you were doing. And you can, more importantly, you can take snapshots of it while it's running. So you can use the Windows Azure Blob Snapshot Server API to create a snapshot of your running VM and it captures that state at that moment. We'll talk a little bit more about metrics and analytics later, but the blob that are on these disks still support the metrics and analytics, so you can analyze the types of IOs that your VM is doing. And the disks are backed by the full Windows Azure storage infrastructure, so it's much more scalable than a traditional disk is. So now I'm going to talk a little bit about the architecture of Windows Azure Storage and some of our design principles, as well as our how we implement such a highly scalable service. So we have a number of design goals for Windows Azure Storage. One is that we want to be highly available with strong consistency. So strong consistency means that when you write your data to the storage system and you get a response back that said that information was successful, then at that point, if you go and turn around and read the data, it's guaranteed that that data that you wrote will be visible there. So it's immediately available. It's very important with a storage service, of course, that your data be durable. And so within the storage service, we replicate the data multiple times and ensure over the lifetime of your application and our application that that data is always going to be there by making lots of copies of it. And also, and we'll talk a little bit later about geo-replication and how we handle making sure the data is transferred and copied enough times. Another design point is to make sure that we can scale to store zettabytes of data and provide that data wherever you are in the world, wherever you have internet service. So we have a global namespace to our service that allows us to do that. And we have a significant effort that we put into making it scalable and load balance across all of the world in order to make it meet that that scalability goal. We have a SOSP paper that goes into great details about the design of that.
Yeah, and one of the benefits is that we run all these three abstractions that we spoke about, or rather all the four abstractions that we spoke about, on the same infrastructure as such, which kind of allows us to mix and match different loads on the same infrastructure and reduce COGS and things like that. So.
So now I'm going to take a moment to go over the sort of design or the implementation of this service. So our service is built into sort of layers. The front-end layer that people can immediately communicate is just a front-end load balance system that spreads requests across a bunch of front-end machines. Below that, we have what we call the partition layer, which is the place where a lot of the logic of handling the service is made. And then we have a DFS, a distributed file system layer. And the distributed file system is the one that handles the replication so that when a disk goes bad or a node goes out, that it doesn't affect the availability of your data. So when you attempt to access your storage account using the blob.core.windows.net-based URL, you'll talk directly to one of these load balancer front ends, and then the what we call the location service that when you go to, well, it actually pushes data to the DNS service, to regular DNS, and then that helps your application decide where to talk to. But you'll talk to that load balancer, and then the partition layers do this, what we call geo-replication, in the back end. So within a storage stamp, we have, as I mentioned earlier, we have a distributed file system at the bottom that handles the replication between the multiple disks and multiple copies of the data that we need to store your data in order to make them sufficiently redundantly stored. This layer is an append-only file system, which is interesting for a variety of reasons, but we're not going to go into too much detail about why we chose that here. The partition layer is the one that understands the abstractions, the blobs, the tables, the queues that we provide for services to use. It also provides it implements this massively scalable index that is used to scale our service up and provide the availability and durability and, that we want to provide.
Yeah, and it's the transaction manager for all the transactions as such, our partition layer, which provides consistency, isolation, snapshot isolation, and things like that.
So the way that this is implemented is there's the index, basically, to all, which is the name of your blobs or tables or queues, is divided up dynamically in a load balance type of a scenario across the by the names that that they have, and then we chop that index up into little pieces based on the load that they have, and then we spread that out across all of the nodes in the partition layer. So when you're talking to our service and making a request, we do a sort of lookup within that index and figure out which machine is currently hosting that piece of the data, and then we forward the request onto that part. We also have a front-end layer, which does the bookkeeping of the service.
Yes. Maybe it manages the authentication, authorization, converts the REST protocol that we support into the internal commands that the partition layer supports. And of course, it's responsible for metrics, billing, logging, and things like that. And like Andy said, it has this bookkeeping of where the partition servers are, so we don't have to keep going to the master and figuring out the partition master to figure out where the partition is being served and things like that. So there are quite a few bookkeeping things that are done in the front end to make this scale to the level that it does today.
So I'll take a moment to go through sort of an example of how a request would go through this system. So in this case, we're doing a write request, where we're going to try to write some data into the system. And so the request will come in to our front-end layer, which will figure out which partition owns that piece of the index, and forward that request onto a machine in the back-end. The machine in the back-end will do a little bit of analysis to figure out exactly what you're doing, whether it's an insert or a delete or whatever have you. But in the end, then it's going to have to do some operation on the back-end, on the disk system, on the distributed file system. And so it forwards that request to, let's say if it was a delete, to delete that row, which means we have to do some sort of a write into three different copies of it to make sure that we know that data is deleted, even if we lose a disk or a node in the back-end. So that request is forwarded off to one disk and then stored on the other two as well. So we can talk a little bit more about how the partition layer load balances the load across all of that index. So it monitors the traffic on each of the nodes in the backend to see which ones are being used more or being used less. And when it sees one that's being used more, for instance, this one request just happened to have gone to, it will realize that the best way to spread that load out is to take that piece of the partition, that piece of the namespace, and divide that into two separate pieces. And then it will take one of those pieces and find a machine or a backend node that's not quite as busy and move that piece of the index, that fraction of the index, over to that one as well. What's really important as far as performance goes in this situation is that we don't want to actually have to copy all of the data associated with that partition or the piece of the partition that we moved. And so we only move sort of the metadata that goes with it, and it's able to read the data from the backend system without having to move it all around.
Yeah, the level of indirection actually allows us to kind of scale this out and make this load balancing really efficient and fast, where we can just move the index range saying, hey, you know, partition server one, you stop serving this, and partition server n, you will start serving this thing. So it's a very fast operation as such, because we don't move data.
The distributed file system is also important that we load balance across it as well. And so it internally monitors the load across all the nodes and replicas within that that layer. And it looks and for reads, it actually is analyzing to determine how long it expects each read to take, and then if it finds that a read from one of those copies of the disk is taking longer than it expects, it'll actually go and read from another one instead, another replica instead. And write load balancing is similar in that we have to find the three different places we're going to write the data, and so it can analyze the load across all those writes and then find one that is, or three, that are less busy than the others in order to write to. So it constantly is dynamically load balancing across all the disks to try to maintain consistent and consistent performance. And also we have to make sure that all of the disks are evenly filled up as well. So that weighs into the algorithm too. So from now we're going to talk a little bit about how we do authentication, so how the client connects to the service and what sorts of different authentication are available for services to read and write their blobs, tables, and queues. Disks are sort of magically handled in the background, mm-hmm. so we don't have to talk about that too much. So we'll talk a little bit about the different types of authentication and how you choose the right authentication, and also how you design your service to be secure for reading and writing to Windows Azure Storage. So we have really three types of authentication that we support. So one is symmetric shared key. One is what we call a shared access signature, or sometimes people will call it pre-signed URL. Or yeah. There's a lot of names.
Authenticated URLs, pre-signed. Yeah.
There's a lot of names for that one, but we'll describe it more in detail to explain what it is. And then finally, we also have public access for blobs, which is a nice thing as well for certain scenarios. So symmetric shared keys is sort of the default built-in, the most common way to read and write your data. So it provides full access to your blobs, tables, and queues. It allows you to read and write, insert whatever your operation are for the different levels of the service. In order to use it, we create what we call a well-known string, or what we call string to sign is the word that we use as well in our documentation. So given a particular request to the storage service, you can go through the headers and create this string to sign from that. The string to sign includes what we call a canonical name for the resource that you're accessing, the blob, table, or queue, the date and time, the HTTP method, put, get, or whatever is in there, as well as other headers that are included within the request. You take that string to sign and you use one of the secret keys associated with your storage account. You have two of them, which we'll explain later how that works for rollover. But you just use one of them and you sign this string to sign, and it gives you back a signature, which you include in your HTTP request. On our side, on the service side, we repeat that operation. We take your request, we create the string to sign, we sign that again, and we compare the signature we create with the one you sent us. If they match, we know you have the shared key and that you're a user of this account. If they don't match, then we reject that request with access denied.
403, yeah.
Yes. So that's the basics of how symmetric shared key access works. And like I said, it gives you full access to your whole service account. So if somebody has your storage account key, they have your storage account and all the data in it, and they can read and write and delete anything that they want. So keep those secret. Shared access signatures, on the other hand, are meant to allow you to create essentially like a token that you can give to somebody else to give them access to a certain part of your storage account. You can give them restrict their access to be like read only or delete only or write only or some combination of those. It also allows you to give them just access for a certain period of time or even for and create them in a revocable method.
So there are multiple ways of creating this token as such. All these parameters that we require to create the token, either you can store it on the container or table that you want to provide access to, in which case you can revoke it, because you can go and change these parameters or just delete these parameters to revoke the access. Or you can embed them in the URI, in which case now, if you've given this token out, they have access, and assume that you're given unlimited time access, then that access can only be revoked by changing your secret key, which we spoke about, the shared key, the 2 512-bit key that you can see on your portal when you sign in. That's the thing that you need to kind of change to kind of revoke the access.
And finally, public service or public access. So for blobs, you can turn a container, a storage account container, which has a set of blobs, or it could have many blobs in it, to public access, which means that the public, someone who doesn't have the authentication signature, is allowed to read that data. So, and you can provide listening access as well. So this would be commonly used for places like if you have a bunch of little tiny bitmaps on your website and you want to be able to link directly to those, so the customers using a web address could read that. So Jay's now going to talk about how to choose the right authentication mechanism and more about security within the service.
Sure. So like Andy mentioned, we have three kind of access types as such that you can choose. The first one being the symmetric shared key authentication that Andy mentioned. Out here, we see that applications tend to use this. They are writing their service, they own the storage account, they trust where this application is running, and so they just store that particular secret key that you have in a config file or something of that sort, and then access it from your application to access storage. And so from a trusted service perspective as such, it is fine to use the shared key as such. Shared access signature, on the other hand, is used not only for third party, but in a lot of cases like compliance where you don't want the secret key or you don't want to give the app more permissions than what it requires. For example, an app is just going to go and run analytics on top of it, so it needs only read-only access to your data. You don't want to provide that app a secret key that you have. Rather than providing a secret key, you can provide the shared access signature token to the app. Again, store that in a configuration file, and we'll go over ways you can store that. And then access this token in your application to only restrict it to read-only access and also time-limited and things like that. So there are a lot of mobile device applications, especially all your apps running in the on your phone or your tablets. These, again, are not, it's not very secure to, especially if you're an app writer. You don't want to obviously give your secret key along with your app. So you'll, again, use shared access signature to restrict access. Public access, like Annie mentioned, if you have images, CDN is an option where you want to serve all these images and make sure it reaches different geo regions as such very efficiently. So you use a CDN, you make it public access, and you can serve these blobs or images out of CDN. Or even browser-based access. Maybe you are writing a public blog as such, so you don't want to restrict read access. So public property basically makes your blobs read-only. You cannot write, you cannot delete, or anything of that sort. So that would be a good way to use public resource. Designing your service for security. A common question that is asked is, yes, I have my secret keys, I have my shared access tokens, right? How do I store it in my application so that it's secure enough? Especially if I have to persist it, right, in your configuration file or in a table or wherever it is. The thing that you would have to do is you would need to kind of encrypt this token, right, and then store this encrypted token or your secret key in the configuration file, and then require cert to decrypt this token that you've just encrypted. And the cert is installed only on the nodes or applications that require the secret key. And so this way you can kind of limit access to it, and it's not readable secret keys in case somebody just jumps onto the box or something of that sort, or it's checked into source depot, it's all encrypted, and you need that cert to kind of decrypt it. How to transfer shared access tokens. So these tokens are pre-authenticated. By that, anybody who has access to that token can access the resource with the given permissions as such. And so you want to make sure that you are transferring these tokens very securely, and obviously so you would need to use HTTPS whenever you're trying to maybe pass a shared access token from your service to a mobile app or your service to a browser, a web service running in a browser or something of that sort. So you always need to use HTTPS for this communication of the tokens. The other common question that we get asked is, how frequently should I change the secret keys or shared access signatures, right? The best answer possible is automated. Once you automate it, you can change it as frequently as needed. There are apps today that need to change it every hour. There are apps that do it every 3 months. So the best answer is, if you automate it, it's not a pain point anymore. You know how to do that, and it's very efficient. And you should always be ready to kind of rotate these keys just in case you figure out through your analytics logs that somebody else is accessing this resource that you hadn't planned for. You can always change your access signature or revoke your SAS tokens and things like that. So you should always be prepared for changing it. Continuing with how you can design, the other thing that we get asked is, how do I rotate secret keys or SAS tokens as such? And you get two 512-bit keys. And you get two keys because now what you can do is push one of these keys, the encrypted one, to your applications to use. So all your applications or services around the world would use this one. You'll push it to all the config files, right? Once you push this, the first key, for example, the second key is not being used, so you can go and rotate this. And then whenever you need to rotate the first one, you will push the second one and then rotate the first one. So you have those two keys so that you can ping-pong between these two secret keys and always rotate the other one using a service management API. How often should I change secret keys or SAS tokens? That's, again, something which we spoke about. And it should be as often as possible. And what should I consider when using shared access tokens? The main thing out there is you need to make sure that there's sufficient buffer for your start time and end time. Clock skews always come into picture. And so if you, let's assume that you set your start time to now, and there's a clock skew, then you want this resource to be accessed right now, but people don't have access to it because there's a clock skew between the server side time and the time that you thought it is at this point. And so the best way is to provide sufficient buffer. The other thing that you can do, especially with start times, if you want to provide access right away, is to not set the start time at all. You have that option because it's an optional parameter as such. Also provide the right granularity of permissions. Make sure that you have the right set of permissions, and especially if you can use your container to start storing these parameters, it becomes much more easy for you to control it. And of course, restrict the resource access. For example, if you want to provide access to a single blob, don't give a listing on the container. Just give SAS access to that particular blob as such rather than the container. And so things like that can be done by limiting it. For tables, you can actually control, within a single table, you can control the starting entity and the ending entity by providing the partition key and row key ranges for your access. So you can control this granularity very well. So yeah. The other thing which is commonly asked is, okay, I'm writing this service that distributes SAS tokens, right, to maybe all the mobile apps out there. What should I do with this? How should I write this service as such? So obviously, you have to ensure that the service that is requesting is authenticated. So you have your own authentication scheme. You shouldn't be giving SAS tokens to everyone. The other thing, if you had to give it to everyone, then as well make it public read access, right? The other thing is use HTTPS to kind of distribute the tokens to your apps or to your clients. And also be aware that these different apps that you may be writing for may be using different storage REST versions as such. And so when we create a shared access signature, the version is embedded in it. So be prepared to at least serve N-1 versions so that you don't force all your apps to kind of upgrade and there's no good story out there. So you always have to kind of at least serve two versions of it so that you don't have any apps breaking when you upgrade your service. Yeah,
so
Andy, take over.
Now we're gonna take a little time to talk about redundancy and how we make sure that we have enough copies of your data worldwide in order to make sure that it's always available to you. So we're going to talk a little bit about the different types of durability that we offer and a little bit about geo-redundancy and how we would do failover if we had something significant happen. And also, we're going to take some time to explain our newer feature that's in preview right now, which is read-only access to the secondary copy when you have geo-redundant copies. So there's really two types of durability that are offered today. One is what we call locally redundant storage, which means that we have the equivalent of three copies of your data within a given region. It costs less than the full geo-redundant storage. And with three copies, we're able to make sure that when we lose a node or a rack or a disk, that we have enough copies so that your data is always available. The second one is what we call geo-redundant storage. So it's basically local, same as the local redundant storage within a region, but then we also make a replica at least 400 miles away in another data center that of that same data. And I'll explain a little bit more about that in a second here. Well, or right now. So with geo-redundant storage, the goal is to make sure that we don't have a regional failure, like a major disaster that takes out a whole data center, and then you wouldn't have your data available to you. So the geo-copy is far enough away that those sort of regional disasters wouldn't impact both data centers. And we provide this geo-redundant storage, or it's available for blobs, tables, and queues, and you get to set on your storage account whether you want the geo version or the locally redundant version. When you create your storage account, you choose the primary region where you want your data stored. So if you want it in the US West or East or Europe, either of the two choices in Europe or Asia. So when you choose that your primary location be, for instance, West US, then your secondary location is automatically the opposite one within that area. So West US is East US, North US is South, and North Europe is West Europe. And the important thing to remember with the geo-replication is that it's asynchronous, and it is not immediately consistent. It's eventually consistent. And so the data that is copied over to that other data center is done sort of in the background and won't be there right away, but it should be there relatively shortly. So failover is something that only happens on this, regional disaster when you have something bad happen, significantly bad happen to a data center. And so how we implement this is that normally you are talking, your client, your service is talking to the DNS service to resolve your storage account name, account.blob.core.windows.net. And that always points at your primary location, in this case, West US, until there's this failover where something has happened in the West US data center and the data is no longer available there. And so we will actually go back and change the DNS entry for account.blob.core.windows.net to now say that is located in East US. And at that point, your clients will still be talking to the DNS server, which will then say, hey, this is over here in East US, and they'll get your data to there. So your URL will keep working after you have this failover. But your data will only be as consistent as we got to before the failover occurred. So it's possible there'll be a brief moment or a brief time of data where your data didn't get copied, where you wrote some data to the West US before it got copied to the East US, and then we'd do a failover, and then it wouldn't be available in the secondary. We're only going to do a failover if the primary, like the West US, could not be recovered. So it's going to take us some time to figure out whether that's true or not, because we can't just like drive down there and look. So typically we replicate that data within minutes, but we provide no SLA for how long it will take to replicate the data to the secondary. So you have to plan that as part of your application. And Jay is now going to take some time to explain secondary read-only access and when you would use that and how you use it. And then he's going to give a demo.
Yeah. So with respect to the secondary read-only access as such, the scenario for secondary read-only access is to get higher availability. So if your primary is not responsive for whatever reason, it's intermittent, it provides intermittent failures or whatever, or even longer failures, you can always go back to your secondary and figure out if you can start reading from your secondary as such. You have to, the fact that Andy mentioned that your secondary is always eventual consistent, you would have to make sure that your application can deal with it. So there are ways to kind of figure out if you want to go to the secondary, and there's an API we provide to kind of see what the last sync time was so that you can figure out if you want to rely on it or not. And so there are a lot of these things that you can do, and we'll go over a demo as such to see how you can make use of your secondary as such. When it gets to kind of secondary read-only access as such, customers kind of using geo-redundant storage has this option. It's currently in preview, and so they have this option of going and applying for this particular preview as such. And once you're approved, you can go turn on read-only access. Once you turn on read-only access, you get two endpoints, the primary endpoint and secondary endpoint. The other thing to note that here is, which is commonly asked, do I get to choose the secondary region? No, these are all paired, as Andy mentioned in the previous slide. So you're, all the regions are paired, so you don't get this option. But you get these two URLs where the secondary actually points to that paired secondary region as such. And the DNS name for that is your account name dash secondary. So as you see, if you use the second DNS name out here, which is highlighted, you can send your request to the secondary. And the secondary can only take read access. Write access will fail if you dispatch that to the secondary. And the one of the things that we kind of strive for is to make sure that the same request actually works on both ends. So if you have a shared access signature or whatever it is, the same request can be sent to both. You don't have to go and reformulate your authentication or something of that sort. And so the same storage keys would work in both places. With respect to consistency, like we said, all writes should go to the primary. Reads that where you need strongly consistent reads, they should go to primary. Where you can deal with this eventual consistency for higher availability, there you can dispatch it to the secondary. So the one of the things that applications can do is in your storage client library, when you provide your endpoints as such, you can control where you want to send it through your retry policy. Through the retry policy and also through your what we call as an option for your request as such, where you can say which location it should go. So there's a location mode where you can say primary or secondary or primary, then secondary and things of that. So you can control the pattern or the location where the request should go to. As I mentioned, we also have provided an API to provide what your geo replication status is and also what your last sync time is, which is basically all objects. If your last sync time is T, then all objects that have been written to the primary before T is available for read on your secondary as such. There will also be a kind of separate storage account metrics as such. We haven't provided logging, but metrics will be available for your secondary location, and it's stored in your primary itself. So let's go through a quick demo. And before I get to the demo, I've just used one of the storage accounts out here in the portal. And as you see, this is the preview program out here. This is now disabled because this account has not been approved to use. However, once you're approved, this particular account out here, which I'm using, is approved for secondary. So if I go to configure, in fact, you can see I've turned on read access from the geo secondary. If I go to my dashboard out here, let me just zoom in out here. This is where you see that you have two different endpoints for each service. The primary is JDemo, and the secondary is JDemo hyphen secondary. And so using these two endpoints, you can now control where the request goes to and also achieve higher availability as such in case your primary is not responding. In addition to that, this also kind of tells you whether you failed over and all these information as such, what your replication status is and things of that. And so all this is provided out here for you in the portal. And let me go over to this particular demo out here. So going to this particular demo, I have my storage account that I'm using. Obviously, I'll be changing my keys as soon as this demo gets done. If you go out here, you can see that there's blob request options that I've used. So what this demo does is it creates the storage account, passing in the connection string that you see out here. And then once you get your connection string, you can create the client. I've created the container. All the writes, remember, have to go to the primary. And then what I do is, I get a block blob reference and then upload some text to it with the tick count, right? And here's another piece of code. And actually, let me just zoom in here. here's a particular piece of code where you see client request ID, RAGRS. Just kind of figure out how we've done this at this point. I'll explain more about it, what a client request ID is, especially when we get to analytics. But I've just used some kind of request ID out here while dispatching this particular request. After that, obviously, I'm trying to download the text. And this time, I've used the primary. Again, I try to download the text, but I use the secondary only options. And the secondary only option is defined here, where the location mode is secondary only. There's a high availability option too, where I've set the location mode to be primary and then secondary. So I dispatch the request to the secondary to download the text. And then, by the way, this blob already exists, so you will see that the secondary read would succeed as such and not return a 404 because it's not there. And then, again, I'm using the high availability option. Out here, I'm going to place a breakpoint out here because I'm going to fool the service that this request, the primary request has failed by using fiddler and breakpoints. And then that'll force the request actually to be dispatched to the secondary. So we'll see that. And then eventually, this is the API that I've been talking about, which is which gives you the status of your replication and also what your last sync time is. So any application that has constraints on how far back you can go and read your data can make use of this API to figure out what your replication status is and also what your last sync time is. Note that the last sync time can be null, so that is why I have this particular piece of code out here, which makes sure that I have a value for the last sync time. It can be null in cases of where there's a lag or a service takes some time to calculate it, or if we need to kind of go, there's some problem with the service as such where it cannot figure what the last sync time is. So there are various kind of reasons why we could return null. So anyway, so this is the program as such. Let me just go ahead and execute this program. And I'm going to start this from scratch again so that I can place a fiddler breakpoint, or rather at least start capturing it on fiddler. And let me just remove all these. So if you go here, and if I try to execute this, as we see, this is your secondary access. It went there, and this is the secondary, or rather, this is the request that went to your primary as such, and this is actually trying to figure out a few more things through my other service that is running out here. But anyways, let me just walk through this. I'm going to enable breakpoints out here so that this particular request is going to fail. And this is the high availability options that we're using out here. And so, I'll have to go back. Set next statement. Back to this. I'm going to update the blog. And we're here and out here. I'm going to edit automatic breakpoints and before requests. And now I'm going to F5. So this particular request, if you see, it's gone to the primary. And I'm going to make it fail. And I didn't make it fail, actually. Sorry. So we're back again, and here this is how I'm going to make it fail. For some reason, it doesn't want to. Yeah. For some reason, it's not intercepting the request on Fiddler. But anyways, if that request had failed, it actually goes to the secondary. But what we can do out here is I'll quickly execute this, and we can see the command line arguments. So if you look at this, the primary option out here kind of gave you the latest. The secondary option had a lag. And then again, the high availability option, because it didn't fail through Fiddler as such, it went through the primary itself. But if it had failed, it would have actually redirected that request to the secondary. It would have completed, and I would have gotten higher availability, but I had to deal with that eventual consistency. With respect to this, let me just run all this to completion and remove the breakpoints. I'm going to run this. So if you look at this again, this is the primary option. It updated it. The secondary option was lagging. And it was lagging because the last sync time was 1855, whereas the primary was updated on 1857. So it'll take some time for it to be updated. The high availability option, again, succeeded on the primary as such. So now, generally, it takes a few minutes for these transactions to be replicated from the primary to secondary. So if you go back to your secondary after the given lag time as such, just remember it's 1855 at this point. At some point, it's going to get replicated, and you can see that the read should be available even on your secondary. And so right now, that read got replicated. It was 1855, and now my previous write got replicated. So my replication is making progress, as I see out here, because the last sync time is moving forward. So this was basically read from secondary, which kind of gives you a feel for how you can use your the location mode as such in your storage client library to get higher availability. Yeah, and with this, I guess we're going to take about a 15-minute break, and we'll get back in 15 minutes to kind of go over best practices and the rest of the deck.